it's been at odds with Palestinians who also lay claim to the Holy Land, thrusting the country into a decades-long conflict. The U.S. is Israel's top ally. Due to the country's shared values and Washington's need for a strategic ally in the Middle East, America has provided years of unparalleled military and diplomatic support. But now those ties are being tested. The Arab Spring, Iran's nuclear ambitions, and Israel's own decision to give Washington the cold shoulder have put new strains on the 65-year-old partnership. Israel and the U.S. joined at the hip. Next, on Great Decisions. In a democracy, agreement is not essential, but participation is. Join us as we explore today's most critical global issues. Join us for Great Decisions. Great Decisions is produced by the Foreign Policy Association in association with Reuters Television. Sponsorship of Great Decisions is provided by ENI, the Herford Foundation, and PricewaterhouseCoopers LLP.
Hello, and welcome to Great Decisions. I'm your host, David Rode. Israel is a strategic American ally in the Middle East, but the relationship between the two countries has been tested by the Arab Spring and Iran's nuclear ambitions. Here with me today to talk about Israeli-American relations is Elliot Abrams. Thank you so much for joining me.
Glad to be here.
You have an amazing view of U.S.-Israeli relations, your service with the Reagan administration, and then again with George W. Bush. A central core of American Israeli relations has been pushing for a peace settlement between the Israelis and the Palestinians. What was the Reagan administration's approach to trying to create a peace agreement between the two sides in the 80s?
I mean, I think the close American-Israeli relations actually start in the 1973 war. You can gauge that by things like the amount of foreign aid going up and up and up. In the Reagan administration, we also wanted some kind of peace deal. But to me, the interesting thing is, in those days, we were flat out opposed to the creation of a Palestinian state.
So no, a peace deal without a two-state solution.
Exactly. I mean, you know, maybe Gaza goes back to Egypt, West Bank goes back to Jordan. Maybe you figure out some affiliation with this, but not two states. That really came, I would say, toward the end of the Clinton administration.
Under George W. Bush. Can you talk a bit about the peace process there, particularly the last several years when there was Annapolis and a big push by Secretary Rice?
Well, Bush wanted a two-state solution, and the Arabs, particularly the Saudis, were pushing very hard for a two-state solution.
And why does Bush support a two-state solution where Reagan didn't?
Reagan comes in, of course, there's a huge time gap, and I think by then it is the only answer.
Oslo has happened, and
yes, you
expectations
had Oslo, you had Camp David with President Clinton. All of that, particularly Camp David and Clinton, is based on the idea of a Palestinian state, independent state. And Bush agreed with that, people should rule themselves. Palestinians should rule themselves. The change Bush made was that he didn't think you create the state, you draw the borders, and you don't really care what's in it. Yasser Arafat, dictatorship, kleptocracy, corruption, doesn't matter. You've created a state. Bush's view, particularly after 9/11, was no. We got to figure out what's going to be within those borders. The borders are less important than the nature of the state. But by the second term, Condi Rice really wanted to have a go at this, and she thought the timing was right. We had a really close relationship with Israel. Sharon had gotten out of Gaza, so you had really the West Bank now is the only thing to focus on. And she certainly gave it the old college try. I thought it wouldn't work. Because
why?
I think,
what specifically doomed it?
I think that now, basically, the most the Israelis can realistically offer is less than the least the Palestinians can realistically accept. If you look at an issue like Jerusalem, I look at, you know, people come up with ideas about Jerusalem, and I think to myself, neither side is going to accept this. There's no obvious compromise.
The domestic politics on either side would not agree.
Exactly. It's just too hard. So I hear people say all the time, I mean, for 40 years we've been hearing people say, the current situation is unsustainable and the window is closing and all that stuff. Well, you know, if you had asked in 1967, do you think this status quo with the Israelis running the West Bank could continue for 40 years? I think everybody would have said, no possible way. Well, you know, here we are. And the likelihood, I think, is it'll continue for a while yet, because they're not really able to make that big compromise deal.
And you said in your memoir about the Bush years that people thought that if we really believe enough in a two-state solution, you know, it would just happen. And do you think that's obviously the wrong approach?
Yeah, I do. I think, by the way, it's what happened with Secretary Kerry, too.
So is Obama sort of making the same mistakes in Secretary Kerry as Secretary Rice did?
Yeah, I think it was interesting when the president went to Israel.
Yes, very early in the second term.
Yeah, he stood in Ramallah and said, you know, two-state solution is critical, and this guy, John Kerry, is going to devote his time and attention to it. And I remember thinking, whoa, he didn't say, the president, am going to devote my time and attention. He's going to devote his time and attention. So I don't know how much the president believes this will happen. I think Secretary Kerry is the real believer. I have to say, I don't see it. That is, it's failed, you know, 10 times. I mean, President Clinton failed, Bush failed, Rice failed, Hillary Clinton failed, Madeleine Albright failed. What's new here? What's new, you might say, is the neighborhood has changed in the Arab Spring. But has it changed for the better in terms of making an Israeli-Palestinian peace deal? I don't quite see why. And the Palestinian leadership is the same leadership we've had since the death of Arafat in 2004. So I just don't understand the optimism.
Since its birth in 1948, no one has given more support to Israel than the United States. Decades of strong diplomatic and military backing continue even today as both sides of a bitterly divided Congress support the relationship. But recently, that bond has been shaken. Like many world leaders, President Obama has put pressure on Jerusalem to craft a, quote, two-state solution to the Palestinian conflict, an agreement to essentially share the land between both sides. But in 2010, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu took a big step in the other direction, expanding settlements on Palestinian land despite American protests. The move cooled ties with Washington for several years. Now, in President Obama's second term, things seem to be back on track. Secretary of State John Kerry has made a number of trips to the region, and both sides of the conflict have agreed to some sort of, quote, two-state solution. Kerry now appears optimistic about breaking the impasse over settlements.
In the long term, you're not optimistic that there'll be a two-state settlement somehow in Obama's second term.
Are we going to have a comprehensive peace deal that no one has ever been able to get? My answer is no. I don't think it's bad to try, but I hope that there's a team B that is preparing for failure and trying to turn failure into success. Let's not have a crash landing here. When this ends in the spring or summer, let's have some achievements to announce and some way forward, which is what didn't happen after Camp David, when it ended up in the Intifada. If you're concentrating on, you know, the comprehensive agreement that leads to the handshake on the White House lawn, you are paying a lot less attention to the day-in, day-out, undramatic work of building the institutions of a Palestinian state, the kind of thing that Prime Minister Fayyad,
who resigned.
He would sometimes say to me, actually, in the Bush years, you're not helping me.
And the complaint from Fayyad and his supporters was that there wasn't enough American assistance or Israeli assistance. Did you trust Fayyad?
Yeah, we all did. I mean, he was extremely popular. I mean, people used to joke he was very popular in Western Europe and the U.S. more than at home.
And he created a security force. He tried
he
to create a more modern economy.
I mean, if you think of sort of Palestine 2005 after Arafat dies, 2010, today, it's much more advanced in terms of moving towards statehood, but I think he was basically right. We were concentrating on a comprehensive deal. So, for example, we would say things to the Israelis like, you guys, you should let some prisoners out. That's the compromise, that's the concession we want, because you're going to have a meeting with President Abbas of the Palestinian Authority in a week, and he needs this before the meeting. Well, that's nice, but what does it do for building a Palestinian state? Nothing. Whereas if you'd ask for economic things, for example, here's what we want. We want you to remove permanently the following four checkpoints.
Which Palestinians for years have said slows the flow of goods, and it makes it impossible for them to grow their economy. Are those legitimate complaints from the Palestinians?
It is a legitimate complaint from Fayyad, of course. One of the culprits in this was his boss, President Abbas, who was also less interested in building the institutions of a Palestinian state. What President Bush used to say to lots of Arab leaders, Israeli leaders, European leaders, was his heart is in the right place, but is he the kind of heroic, charismatic leader who can take them to the promised land? And I think we were right to be doubtful, because remember, at the end, which is to say, the very end of 2008, then Prime Minister Olmert made a pretty generous offer to President Abbas, and he never even really replied. He never gave an answer, which is in essence a no. And we thought one of the reasons was that in Palestinian politics, to make the compromises necessary for a comprehensive deal would just be murder. I mean, just think what Hamas would say. You're a traitor. Arafat never signed. You signed. You've given away everything. It's very tough. And the question was he a tough enough guy to make that deal? I think the answer is no.
And how generous was that offer, in your view, from Olmert? Was that a moment when there might have been a settlement and it was missed, an opportunity was lost?
Yeah, it was very generous in terms of territory. That is, they would take 5% of the West Bank for the major settlement blocks and give land from Green Line Israel, 1967 Israel, to make up for it. So the square footage of Palestine is not diminished. There was a deal on Jerusalem where there would be shared sovereignty under an international kind of condominium, US, Jordan, Palestinians, Israel, Saudi Arabia. He didn't compromise much on refugees. The so-called right of return was going to be, I think, 5,000 a year for 5 years. And that, maybe that's what killed it for Abbas, having to say to a couple of million Palestinian refugees, you're out.
No right of return. Just back to sort of Obama, and then Fayyad, who I think is a figure many Americans don't know, but he, mm-hmm. It was amazing that he was so impressive to people in Washington who knew him, you know, in terms of the Obama administration. So Fayyad resigns in frustration in the summer of 2013. Mm-hmm. Should the Obama administration have done more to stop that? Should John Kerry have done more to stop that? Did you see him as even a successor to Abbas, or was Fayyad not?
He's not a charismatic leader. He's a technocrat.
But he's the ideal. When you look at the Palestinians and you see Hamas and the radicals that exist in many corners of the region, this man, again, Fayyad, is very impressive.
Look, I think he's great. I mean, he's every American's view of what we want in a Palestinian leader. Question is he every Palestinian's view?
And it is their country.
And they're going to have elections sooner or later. I mean, they haven't had them in a very long time, since 2006. But sooner or later, and he'll run. You know, let him run for president. Let's see. I think Kerry should have made more efforts to keep him there, because I think for a lot of donors, European, American, Arab, he was the guarantee of no corruption. And I would have to say to you, I think corruption is increasing. One of my jobs in the Bush administration was to go to Arab donors, particularly in the Gulf, and ask them to give, you know, we're giving hundreds of millions to Palestinians. You should give more. And very often they would say things like, they'll just steal it. It'll end up in Zurich.
But did Fayyad have a better reputation among even there?
Yes.
And in terms of the region, one of the arguments Kerry has made is that actually the instability in the region makes it more sense for Netanyahu to compromise, and that as you've got chaos in Syria and instability in Egypt, maybe Abbas is not the worst partner. Do the Israelis see it that way?
Very few see it that way. Let's say you're going to take Israeli troops out of the West Bank. Okay, you're going to come back to some new border, and the West Bank is now Palestine. What happens if the King of Jordan is overthrown? What happens if there's chaos in Jordan? Their security border used to be the Jordan River. So now it's back. Who's protecting against the inflow of, let's say, arms or terrorists from Jordan into the new state of Palestine? Well, now the king, and everybody trusts the king. What if the king's not there? What if Jordan's in chaos? What's the future of Syria? What's the future of Egypt? I mean, right now the Israelis are delighted because the Egyptian army took over from President Morsi. They look like
very forcefully.
Yes, and it looks like they're going to be there for a while. Mm-hmm. So the Israelis are happy, and the army is very concerned, the Egyptian army, to restore order and prevent terrorism in Sinai. But where will Egypt be 5 years from today? Who knows?
The other issue that Kerry brings up is the sort of campaign to delegitimize Israel, that the Palestinians will go back to the UN. This is not happening now because of the talks, but they'll push for statehood, and that particularly Europe will push to ostracize Israel and cut off investment there and other things. Does that pressure Netanyahu?
The key issue there today is the settlements and settlement expansion. So if somehow they could strike a deal on that, then the delegitimization campaign, at least as it involves European governments, would diminish. But I would have to say, I think they're right to be concerned about that. I think the level of support for Israel is even less than it appears to be, because you have a lot of leaders, Merkel in Germany, for example, Sarkozy, then Hollande, Blair, and then Cameron, who are actually a lot more pro-Israel than their own populations. So I think the Israelis do have a problem in Europe. Maybe a different government of Israel would be able to do a settlement freeze or a partial settlement freeze, and that would relieve a good deal of the pressure.
And was Obama right to push for a settlement freeze?
I think it was a mistake because of the way he did it, which was to say everything has to be frozen, everything. Large settlements, small settlements, Jerusalem, all construction. Problem with that is that something like 90% of Israelis don't agree to that. If you say we need to freeze in the small settlements that are out there in the middle of what's going to be Palestine, I would say something like 75-80% of Israelis agree with you and view those settlers as ideologues.
More provocative and
yeah, whereas in the major blocks, most Israelis say, hey, we're going to keep those in the end, and that's just kind of suburban life. Those people are just like you and me. And Jerusalem is our capital, they will say. So politically, what you're doing when you do what Obama did is you're creating a big anti-freeze coalition. If you separate it out and say, we just want to freeze in those little settlements out there, then you've got most Israelis with you, and you might be able to do that in terms of Israeli domestic politics.
Another argument Kerry has made is about the demographics in Israel, and that there has to be a two-state solution just because the Palestinian population growth will be larger and larger, and the whole idea of a democratic Israel, you know, could be threatened. Do you agree with that demographic argument?
The demographics are not as bad as they looked some time ago, because as Arab societies, for example, Palestine, get more educated, wealthier, women have fewer children.
Yeah.
Whereas in Israel, the Orthodox are having
lots of children. Many more children, yes.
So it's not the way it used to look. But it is certainly true that Israelis don't want a one-state solution.
Some Israelis say that, you know, that there's been great offers, one from Omer that we talked about earlier, and that the problem is the Palestinians won't agree to some kind of confederation with Jordan.
Suppose you have an independent Palestine tomorrow morning. It's going to have an organic relationship with Jordan. It's going to use the Amman airport, not Tel Aviv airport. It's going to use probably Aqaba more than Eilat. It's going to probably have a free trade agreement with Jordan. It's probably going to use Jordanian currency. Organic economically, customs union. It seems to me it's perfectly logical to say that's going to bleed over into an organic political relationship, develop into an organic political relationship too over
but
time.
But can a Palestinian leader get away with politically
saying that?
That
now?
And agreeing to we are not an independent Palestine.
No.
They have
no.
to have that.
I remember they have to have the sovereign right to choose that arrangement or to stay completely independent permanently.
For decades, bloodshed ravaged Israel. Until in 1978, Israel and its neighbors signed the Camp David Accords. Brokered by Jimmy Carter, the agreement ended a war and settled the boundaries between Israel and Egypt. The resolution also recognized Gaza and the West Bank as Palestinian states. But recent events are threatening the decades of relative stability surrounding Israel. To its west, the Arab Spring has given rise to democratically elected Islamist governments, governments which may choose not to follow the policies of their forerunners. To its north, the Syrian conflict threatens to spill over to the entire region. Regional factions like Hezbollah are already joining in a conflict they see as Sunni versus Shia. And to its east, Israel is ever wary of Iran's nuclear ambitions. Though Iran claims its pursuits are peaceful, it's hard, if not impossible, for Israel to trust a nation whose former leader called for the extermination of an Israeli state. Those fears have nudged the U.S. and Israel closer to a possible military intervention.
Some have been critical of Obama that he has not been aggressive enough about Iran and the use of force. Is there a diplomatic solution, possibly, with President Rouhani of Iran?
Well, we all want a diplomatic solution, and I think it is possible. I don't think it's hard to draw up what would we want in such a solution. What we want, basically, is to pull them back further from having a nuclear weapon.
Some Israelis have said they want nothing at all. Iranians have said their bottom line is a civilian nuclear program. They have to have some kind of program.
The question to me is whether that's actually the bottom line of the supreme leader, the Ayatollah Khamenei. I think a lot of American experts would accept, okay, 3.5% enrichment with X number of centrifuges and no more.
And very tight monitoring.
Very tight monitoring and a low amount of enriched uranium. Because after all, you guys are saying, you Iranians, this is for nuclear energy. So how much do you need for your one nuclear reactor at Bushehr? Very small amount. Is that acceptable to the Ayatollah? I'm not sure. I mean, ultimately, we'll find out. But I think there is a diplomatic deal available to us and which we want. I don't know if the Ayatollah will agree to it. And I think, you know, the idea of an agreement with the U.S. itself offends many Iranians, and we saw this.
And the Iranians have also signaled they want a reduction in the sanctions against Iran.
Well, that will come if we do a deal. I mean, that.
But
that,
only if there's a deal.
Absolutely.
Don't ease up on the sanctions until we see concrete changes from.
If we're going to make a concession, let's have a concession from the Iranians. This does not mean there will never be a military attack, because the negotiations can fail. They can break down. Or they can apparently succeed, and then we find out the Iranians are cheating and have one or two or three secret sites. Perfectly plausible.
There's this opening, it seems, with Rouhani, but at the same time, you know, he's backed by the Revolutionary Guard, which is clearly adamant about wanting a nuclear weapon. I mean, is this a bluff, or as the Supreme Leader really, will he accept not having a nuclear weapon?
I don't think so. I mean, that is, I do think, I wouldn't call it a bluff, I'd call it a tactic.
Mm-hmm. More time. To continue enrichment.
Yeah, which they've done for 10 years. I mean, they've had a very successful policy. Don't leap ahead in a way that makes the Americans or Israelis do something, but slowly and steadily move toward a nuclear weapon. I think it is logical in many ways for Iran to want a nuclear weapon, to be a great power like, you know, China and India, United States, Britain, France.
And for North Korea, it's helped. Once in Pakistan, once you obtain a nuclear weapon, this regime change, yeah, which these countries fear, and doesn't happen.
And for what? To get a mile away from a nuclear weapon? I don't think so. I don't think this is a scientific experiment. I think it's to get a nuclear weapon and to be a great power. That, I think, is the Ayatollah's ultimate goal.
If there was military action, can the Israelis do it on their own?
They can do enough to damage the program and set it back several years. The way they put it, and I think it's actually well put, they don't need us for the day of or the day after, they need us for the 10 years after. Because after such an event, you have to have some kind of international agreement still on the Iranian nuclear program.
Do you think the American public will be willing to continue to provide so much aid to Israel in the future? Mm-hmm. Should we? I mean, we're very close allies. Should we continue that aid?
Well, the gas bonanza is in the future. So for the moment, my answer would be yes. But I think the day will come when Israel will first stop getting an increase in aid, and then the aid will start to decline. You know, we don't give economic aid anymore because they got too rich. And I would say that over the next 10 years, this question will arise, and the military aid will start going down. And I keep telling the Israelis, our relationship doesn't depend on aid. We have intimate military relations with, you know, Japan, Canada, England, Australia. They're not aid recipients. So it's a different relationship. It's less dependence, and that may actually even be a good thing.
Are we betraying Israel by cutting the aid? Or
I think the opinion polls really are steady for like the last 10 years. Support for Israel remains very high, even in this Middle East where Americans basically say, get me out of here.
Enough.
Support for Israel is very high, and I think that a change in the aid levels could even increase that support. So I think that is a direction to go in, not this year, but if you're looking out 10 years, I think that is a direction to think about.
Great. Thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure.
Come back for more on the great decisions that make our foreign policy. I'm David Rode. Thank you.
Despite icy relationships between its leaders, Israel and the U.S. are inextricably linked. The U.S. is Israel's top trading partner, and the nations share many of the same values. The U.S. now wants its ally to engage in a series of new talks with the Palestinians, what it calls, quote, confidence-building measures. These small agreements would build trust between the two groups, laying the groundwork for a more permanent solution. It's a clever idea, but one that may gain little traction, at least as long as the rest of the region remains mired in unrest. To learn more about topics discussed on Great Decisions in Foreign Policy, visit our website at www.greatdecisions.org. Start the discussion of U.S. foreign policy in your community. Find out how at www.greatdecisions.org/leader. Great Decisions is produced by the Foreign Policy Association in association with Reuters Television. Sponsorship of Great Decisions is provided by ENI, the Herford Foundation, and PricewaterhouseCoopers LLP. Turkey is a nation at a crossroads. The NATO member nation is a longtime ally of the Western powers. It stands on the border with the East, the last outpost of American and European influence in a region that is less secular by the day. But the soul of Turkey is very much up for grabs.